All right. We've got a chock full panel here, so I'm going to try to keep it moving. Our topic now is going to be employment disputes, arbitration of employment disputes. And as you can see, we are full of speakers, so I'm going to try to keep everybody on time so everyone has a chance to speak. If you're starting to go over, I'm going to start singing like they do at the Oscars. Ooh. Progressively louder, and you really don't want to hear that. No, I will signal to you guys. But our first speaker and our first topic is going to be preemption under the Federal Arbitration Act, as well as conflict with statutory rights. We just heard a little bit about National Labor Relations Act. Now we're going to talk about other statutory rights, and we've got a great speaker for this. Zach Fasman is a partner at Proskauer Rose in the Labor and Employment Department. He has many, many years of experience representing employers in all sorts of employment and labor issues. And so not to take up his time, I won't go through his very lengthy resume, which is in your books. And I will turn it over to you, Zach.
Thank you, Elena. So I always speak standing up. It helps me think. And also, when you're vertically challenged, it also helps to stand up. Thank you for that for the introduction, Phil. It was always a pleasure to follow you. Always good to see you. I remember Phil when he got out of law school. That was a long time ago. And it's I also enjoyed your mention of the CNN litigation. I can testify that it was, in fact, 82 days of trial and 16,000 pages of transcript, and I was there for everyone, as was my friend and colleague, Sandy Dubin, who is now with NYU. I think we drove her out of the private practice. And some of the other people from the NLRB. I saw a bunch of other people who were involved in their trial. The only thing that's going to be longer than that is McDonald's, and I don't intend to go there. But let's talk about arbitration and statutory claims. The way I looked at this was that I would give a broad overview of the various topics, and then we're going to get some drilling down on the various issues that are involved. So take this as the survey course, and then we'll get involved in each individual area. For those of you who looked at your program and who looked at my title just now, you'll notice that there's only two cases, not three, and that is because Zaborowski, which is a great case and which I'll mention a little bit, got settled before the Supreme Court had a chance to rule on it. So I took it out, it got into the program, but in any event, it was an interesting case. Too bad we can't talk about it. As Phil said, the real question here is the role of arbitration in employment-related claims that are not NLRA, that are not attributable to the NLRA. Okay, so in other words, employment-related claims, employment discrimination claims, Fair Labor Standards Act claims, statutory claims, and how they are resolved and whether they should be resolved in arbitration. As Phil said, the Federal Arbitration Act, I was not around in 1925, thank God, but the Federal Arbitration Act did in fact have the purpose that Phil talked about, which is to remove hostility, judicial hostility to arbitration, and to have the courts be somewhat more receptive to the notion that statutory rights and private rights could be resolved in arbitration. Initially, in the employment area, that did not happen. And one of the reasons it did not happen is another thing that Member Miscamara mentioned, which is the Steelworkers Trilogy. At the time these early cases came up, arbitration in the employment area was based upon labor arbitration, that is, resolution of rights under a collective bargaining agreement. Those issues are the issues that the Supreme Court talked about in the Steelworkers Trilogy, and those issues, there was a whole area of law that was developed to deal with those types of issues. And initially, when cases came up dealing with the enforcement of statutory rights, Fair Labor Standards Act rights, Title VII rights, initially, the courts looked at the labor arbitration field and said, not so good. we don't like this that much. Alexander versus Gardner Denver is the classic example. In Alexander, which was a race discrimination case, an individual both arbitrated and then sought to litigate the same cause of action based on race discrimination one after the other. And the courts said, no barrier. The fact that you have arbitrated this case doesn't preclude you then from going forward and litigating the case in court. And to give you a picture, because we did hear the poetry from the Steelworkers trilogy, here's the contrary poetry from Gardner Denver. Parties usually choose an arbitrator because they trust his knowledge and judgment concerning the demands and norms of industrial relations. On the other hand, the resolution of statutory or constitutional issues is a primary responsibility of the courts, and judicial construction has proven especially necessary with respect to Title VII, whose broad language frequently can be given meaning only with reference to public law concepts. Moreover, the fact-finding process in arbitration usually is not equivalent to judicial fact-finding. The record of arbitration proceedings is not as complete. The rules of evidence don't apply. You get the idea. And this is the Supreme Court in 1974 saying, no, we're not doing this. This is not the right forum for this. Interesting that this all begins to change with regard to other statutes in the 1980s. And these cases that you see on the board before you, Mitsubishi Motors and Shearson Lehman, these are all cases dealing with different statutes. Mitsubishi dealt with the Clayton Act, the antitrust laws. Shearson Lehman dealt with RICO. And all of them are dealing with not labor arbitration, but commercial arbitration, where parties to a commercial contract get together and say, listen, let's not go to court and spend $2 gazillion on discovery. Let's see if we can't resolve this in a faster, more expedient manner, in a fashion so that we can resolve our disputes. And the Supreme Court in these cases, beginning in the 1980s, said, okay, let's let them do that. You could say if you took a jaded view of this, you could say the courts wanted to get these cases out of the courts, there was overcrowding, or however you want to deal with it. But in all of these cases, the Supreme Court said, look, arbitration and agreements to arbitrate are just an agreement to resolve a dispute in an alternative forum. They don't affect substantive rights. That choice doesn't affect substantive rights. You can enforce your rights in an alternative forum, and you can do it under these various statutes. And the court, in all of these cases, and if you read them, they're really quite stunning, because counsel opposing arbitration came up with every conceivable argument against it. They said, look, Congress in the Sherman Act, the Clayton Act, authorized treble damages, punitive remedies, because it was so important. In RICO, there's treble damages as well. And in every case, the Supreme Court said, yeah, and? What's the end of the sentence? Just send it to arbitration. As long as you can get the same remedies, as long as you can vindicate those rights, you're good to go. And so these cases came up with the three rules on the bottom of this slide. Arbitration is appropriate for statutory claims unless first Congress has said no. There is an inherent conflict between arbitration and the statutory claim, which is hard to figure out. And as long as the individual, the plaintiff, is able to vindicate his or her or its statutory rights in arbitration. And that really is the question. So as I say, inherent conflict between arbitration and a statutory right, it's hard to imagine what an inherent conflict would be. The vindication of statutory rights. What types of cases are we talking about? Cases where remedies are inappropriate, and we've all seen these. Zaborowski was one of those cases, by the way, where you can't get the same damages in arbitration, where there's a limitation on the recovery of punitive damages, or there's a limitation on the recovery of attorney's fees. Under Title VII, you're entitled to attorney's fees. In the Zaborowski case, they said the prevailing party, whoever that is, gets attorney's fees, which means if you lose, you pay the employer's fees for the plaintiff. Not a good idea. Zaborowski is an example of the types of clauses you don't want to draft if you're looking for an enforceable agreement. The procedures may be inappropriate, due process problems, inappropriate statute of limitations, all of those issues can can be out there. All of this was extended to the employment area, to the area of employment rights not attributable to a labor contract or the National Labor Relations Act in Gilmer versus Interstate Johnson and Lane, an age discrimination case in 1991, where the court said, you know, some good for commercial cases, good for employment cases. There's no inherent conflict between resolving an employment discrimination case in arbitration and the statutes. This is just a choice of forum. You can arbitrate these cases just as well. Gilmer in the employment area has been followed many, many times in many, many cases. It is well accepted law. And in terms of individual rights, that is, if I want to file an age discrimination case and I have a commitment to arbitrate, it's perfectly acceptable to resolve those rights in arbitration. The court said that all along. So these rights on an individualized basis are enforceable in it where there is an enforceable and a legitimate arbitration procedure. There's always been some doubt in this area about the vindication of statutory rights. And where all of these doubts and where all of these issues come to play with regard to the issue of statutory claims is with regard to class actions and class action waivers. Now, why is this the case? Many individual employment rights, as you know, have been brought in class actions. In fact, I think it's fair to say that one of the major drivers of social change in the United States in this area has been the private class action lawsuit. With all due respect to my friends at the EEOC, they're not big enough to police all of industry throughout the United States. It's hard to imagine an agency that would be big enough to police everything from New York City to Montana to California. I mean, it's an unbelievable job. So a lot of the big cases that have come down, Griggs versus Duke Power, et cetera, are all private lawsuits. Now, there have been some important, you know, Justice Department lawsuits, Hazelwood School District, Teamsters. There have been a number of very important government-brought lawsuits, but basically, the driver of change in this area has been private class actions. Obviously, if you have class action waivers underlying available and an employer does not have to entertain a class action, it's an important development, as the New York Times series on this would tell you. It also raises an issue on, to my mind, of arbitral competence. For those of us who have litigated complicated employment class actions with industrial psychologists and statisticians and all of these crazy people who make their living doing wonderful things and trying to elucidate whether a series of decisions was or was not discriminatory and who come up with opinions that I'm always amazed by, on both sides, by the way. But these are very complicated matters, and there's a question in my mind as to the competence of most arbitrators to deal with those issues. These are not people who have law clerks lying around who can do research on statistical methods and things like those issues. So let's talk about how this has come up. There have been two basic questions in this area with regard to class procedures. One of them is are class action procedures available in arbitration, number one? And the second is, can employers use a class action waiver, or businesses use a class action waiver to avoid such claims? So let's look at those. This is not a trilogy. This is sort of a tetralogy, or if Zaborowski was around, you'd have five cases. I'm not sure what that term even means. But here's the way the courts have dealt with this, and I'm just setting the table here for later speakers. Stolt-Nielsen deals with question one: are class action procedures available in arbitration? Stolt-Nielsen, the parties said, it's a maritime case, not an employment case, but in Stolt-Nielsen, the parties said, we had no meeting of the minds. Nobody talked about class action procedures in arbitration. Who knows? And the Supreme Court said, listen, the rule is, in the absence of agreement to the contrary, class use of class procedures in arbitration is contrary to the informality and the efficiency and the normal run of arbitration. And therefore, in the absence of a statement that says class action procedures are going to be available, they're not available. Arbitration is flexible, it's informal and fast, and it's not consistent for that to be the case where you have a class action. Those of us who have handled class actions in the federal courts know that it wasn't quite as long as CNN, but those are extensively litigated cases. So Stolt altered pre-existing law, because up until that time, people had thought, well, if it's a question of arbitral procedure, doesn't the arbitrator rule on arbitral procedure? That's been the law forever, and it certainly looked the law under the NLR, labor arbitration. The arbitrator decides procedural issues. The Supreme Court said no, and raised a bunch of, there are a bunch of interesting issues raised with regard to Stolt. If you don't have a meeting of the minds, what can you do to litigate this stuff? How much proof should there be? Who does the proof? You can see this later. It's not critical, but there's some big issues there left under Stolt. Arbitrators had also said that silence allows class actions, which is an interesting proposition. I have many friends in the arbitral profession, and they're not stupid. If they have a choice between a case that's a one-day case and a choice between that and a class action, it's a good way to make a living. I don't ascribe that type of venal motivation to my friends and most arbitrators. But, you know, arbitrators had uniformly said, I'll listen to a class action. How many days is it? Three? No, it's 300. No, well, that's a different ballgame. That's something different. But in any event, in Jack versus Sterling Jewelers, which I'm sure we're about to hear about, the former magistrate, Southern District Magistrate Judge Kathleen Roberts said, sure, I'll listen to this class action, and I'm sure we're going to hear what's going on there. In Oxford Health Plans versus Sutter, another class case, to give you an idea of how this area proceeds, no civil action shall be instituted before any court, and all such disputes should be subject to final and binding arbitration. The parties agreed to submit to the arbitrator the question of whether class procedures were available. The arbitrator said, well, all such disputes. That means all such disputes, which includes class actions, right? That makes sense. And a number of us said, what are you talking about, by the way? And it went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, based upon limited review of limited judicial review of arbitration awards, said, yeah, you know, it's passable. All such disputes, you could construe it that way. We're not going to get involved in this. And of course, the court said in Oxford Health, they said, now, if this had been a question of arbitrability, if you had couched it in a different fashion, we might have a different rule. But you couched it as a question of contract construction, and therefore, we're going to affirm the award. So, as I say, there was evidence from the contract, which it's referenced to civil actions, that the court found. And this is, the second bullet point up here is really one of the most interesting points, which is, let's say you have a class action in arbitration. We're going to hear a little bit about that on collateral estoppel. But let's say you have a class action in arbitration, Title VII or a wage hour class action, and it's litigated. How about an absentee party? There's no Rule 23, no preclusion. It's not the standard federal court deal, but there's an arbitration, and some of the parties, for whatever reason, who are not present, absent class members, don't like the result. Are they bound by it? I mean, that's the point that Justice Alito and Justice Thomas made, and the answer is, who knows? We haven't faced that yet. At least I'm not aware of cases on that point, but it's a very, very significant question when you consider these issues. All right, a couple of additional ones. Question two, class action waivers. This is the second question I mentioned, not whether class procedures are available on arbitration, but can an employer promulgate a class action waiver? in AT&T Mobility versus Concepcion. This is a consumer case in which AT&T got everybody to sign a contract that said, we will arbitrate all of these matters and they'll all be done on an individual basis. In this case, which was really a preemption case, the state of California had a rule that said that arbitration agreements are unconscionable if they contain a class action waiver, the Discover Bank rule, and it went to the Supreme Court on whether that was consistent with the Federal Arbitration Act. A 5-4 decision written by Justice Scalia, in which he said, listen, it's not consistent with the Federal Arbitration Act. If you have an arbitration agreement, you don't have to have that rule, and that's not a rule that is neutral with respect to arbitration. In other words, that the Federal Arbitration Act requires that arbitration contracts be treated like every other contract, and this does not treat them like every other contract. There's a very interesting decision and a very significant one that builds on Stolt-Nielsen. Back to question one again. I'm doing these in chronological order, not in necessarily the appropriate order. In CompuCredit versus Greenwood, this was also not an employment case, and it extended the rule to agreements to arbitrate according to their terms to all contracts, even where, in this case, this was the Credit Repair Organization Act, which I'm sure you all know and were involved in. But they said that people should have a right to sue. And the court said, yeah, right to sue means a right to sue in arbitration if you've agreed to arbitrate it. So it's a fascinating claim. We'll go through that. And then finally, the last one I'm running out of time. The first one on my paper, which is American Express. American Express, Italian Colors, is an antitrust case. And in it, the question was one of class action waivers. In this case, this is an antitrust claim where the plaintiffs all had minimal claims if they didn't enforce them through a class action. There was no reason to get an expert whose fees would not be recoverable. And in this case, this was decided three times by the Second Circuit. The Second Circuit kept saying, well, there's no per se rule one way or the other as to whether a class action waiver is or is not appropriate, but we'll leave it for the lawyers, which is always great for us. But they basically did not come back with a precise rule. The Supreme Court reversed and said, listen, the unavailability of a class action is not a barrier to the enforcement of a class action waiver, and a barrier to the enforcement of an otherwise valid arbitration agreement. Nothing in the antitrust laws requires that these cases be heard on a class basis. That's not necessary. Class actions weren't even available when the Sherman Act was passed, and therefore, we don't need to get to it. And here's the more important issue. The vindication of statutory rights, which we began talking about some time ago, says that this applies even where an individual may not be able, for financial or economic reasons, may not make sense to bring the lawsuit on an individualized basis. The court says, and you get a right to bring a lawsuit. You don't get a right to win that lawsuit. You get a right to pursue your cause of action, but you don't necessarily get a right to prevail or a right to file a lawsuit that makes sense. There's a powerful dissent, a 3-member dissent written by Justice Kagan, who says, wait a minute, American Express just insulated itself from all forms of class actions, no more, slightly less directly than if they said you can't file an antitrust claim against us. And that was her point, saying if there is no such thing as vindication of statutory rights, Why is there, there's just no way to vindicate these rights absent a class action. So is there anything left of the vindication of statutory rights? Not much. Maybe if there's a limitation on recovery. Maybe if there's a reversal of the normal rules of recovery of attorney's fees, both of which were in Zaborowski. But aside from that, not much going on. Yes. That is certainly possible, and that's exactly what I think that's right. No, I agree. So it was possible to prove the case. All right, there's a summary from the Supreme Court which basically says class action procedures are not available, generally speaking. Class action waivers are generally enforceable. And none of this matters if an arbitrator has already ruled on this subject, because then you may lose and you may get class action procedures, whatever you like. The second case I was asked to talk about, with about a minute left, is DirectTV versus Imburgia, which is another consumer case in which DirectTV said, if you want a service agreement with us, Professor Estreicher, here's a class action waiver. And they said, however, this class action waiver and the arbitration provision will be unenforceable if the law of your state makes this unenforceable. Well, remember in Concepcion, the law of California at the time this contract was signed did in fact prohibit class action waivers. So the question goes to the Supreme Court. California courts, who don't like arbitration, when everything in the California courts said, this is plainly, this refers to California state law, goes up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court reverses with only Justice Ginsburg and Justice Sotomayor in dissent. And the majority says, what is it? Is there something that's abstruse about Article 6, Section 2 of the Constitution? I mean, the supremacy clause? Because we just already ruled on this. This is covered by Concepcion. You people in California are not getting it. There's a two-person dissent, but it's important. It's an important question for two reasons, and that is that it's a six-member majority. And here's what I'd like to leave you with. It's a key issue because Justice Scalia was the most vociferous and the greatest champion of arbitration of statutory rights, and of course, he unfortunately passed away. He wrote the majority in Concepcion. He wrote the majority in Amex. What is his absence going to mean for the court in the future? And if you watch what the court's done, there's been in several different cases in the employment area, I don't have time to go into it, but there have been, the dissents have become the majority opinion in several different areas, even today, before there is a justice appointed, obviously. President Obama is having trouble with that, but we'll see who's elected president. But this may come up, the enforceability of class action waivers, when you have 5-4, 5-3 rulings, this may certainly come up. Where could this happen? Well, it could happen with the National Labor Relations Act, right? The board has continued to rule under D.R. Horton and all the cases that Member Miscamara talked about. The board has continued to rule that these are unlawful under the National Labor Relations Act. You now have a split in the circuits with the Seventh Circuit going the other way, and I gather we're going to hear a little debate on that between Willis Goldsmith and Professor Estlund. And in addition, the EEOC has gotten into the mix because they have filed a case, EEOC versus Doherty Enterprises, where they said, by the way, a class action waiver is an enforcement of one, is a pattern or practice of resistance to rights under Title VII. So I'll leave it there and sit down. Thank you for allowing me to go 2 minutes over. Thank you.
Thank you, Zach. So our next speaker is Kalpana Kotagal. And she is a partner at Cohen, Milstein, Sellers, and Toll in the Civil Rights and Employment Practices Group. And she actually is going to tell us about what happens if you don't have a waiver of class actions in your arbitration agreement and you end up with a class action arbitration. And she's she can speak to this very well because she's actually involved in one right now. She represents a class of more than 40,000 female sales employees in the case of Jock versus Sterling Jewelers. And it's a gender discrimination disparate impact claim. And she's going to tell us a little bit more about that and about class arbitration.
This is a really neat group. I'm really delighted to be here, Sam. Thank you for the invitation. As Elena mentioned, and I think as Zach touched on, I've had some very interesting experiences over the last 8 or so years in the Jock v. Sterling Jewelers case, which is, I think, one of the few cases that has sort of danced through all of these various hurdles around an arbitration agreement that is silent as to whether class action procedures are available. So we sort of scooted around the Stolt-Nielsen issue, went up to the Second Circuit on that. Cert was denied on that question by the Supreme Court, so we scooted that issue. And then we had to confront what it looks like to actually certify a class in arbitration. Hundreds of pages of briefing, thousands of pages of expert reports, hundreds of exhibits, 2 days of hearings before former magistrate judge Kathleen Roberts, resulting in certification of a nationwide class. That brought together both these really challenging issues around arbitration and class-wide arbitration, and post-Walmart, how do you certify a class? How do you certify a nationwide class? And so it confluence of very complicated, very interesting issues. Judge Rakoff confirmed the arbitrator's order on that. That's currently on appeal to the Second Circuit. We just filed our brief last week. And just 2 days ago, Sterling filed a notice of appeal as to the conditional certification of a collective action of our Equal Pay Act claim. So this is a wide-ranging and incredibly complicated case. Many experts, many lawyers. Sterling is ably represented by Jerry Mattman and his team at Seyfarth Shaw. I'll just note that we have had months, and we're in one of those months right now, where we are literally litigating this case in three fora. We're before Judge Roberts in arbitration, pursuing discovery. We have a trial date that we are pushing towards on our class claims. We are before the district court and Judge Rakoff hearing appeals of Judge Roberts' decisions. And we're briefing to the Second Circuit on issues of how do you, whether our class definition is sustainable in arbitration. It's a little bit tricky. Interestingly, Zach mentioned this issue of collateral estoppel and Justice Alito's concurrence, joined by Justice Thomas in the Oxford Health case. He said that there hasn't been any sort of law on that. I just point you to, this is exactly what's on appeal in Jock v. Sterling Jewelers and our class certification issue. So very interesting decision from Judge Rakoff from November of last year, and now two briefs to the Second Circuit, Sterling's reply brief due soon, and ultimately oral argument and hopefully a clear decision from the Second Circuit. It puts very squarely this issue is addressed. I want to focus my comments on some of my own experiences litigating class arbitration. I think over the last several years, so much of the discussion of class-wide arbitration has focused on the Concepcion and Italian colors questions of the enforceability of class arbitration waivers, the effective vindication of rights doctrine, what's left of that doctrine. I thought I'd spend some time discussing two slightly different, related, but slightly different topics with you. The first is that I'd like to spend some time just offering some observations based on my own experience about the practical realities of litigating in class arbitration from my work in the Sterling Jewelers case. what does that look like? What does it mean? How does it contrast in reality to litigating Title VII cases in federal court? And then second, I thought I'd turn to an issue that's been simmering in the background since Basel that Zach touched on in Stolt-Nielsen, and I think is poised to bubble up again. The question whether the clause construction determination is a gateway issue. Who makes that decision? Is it a judge or an arbitrator who construes the contract to the arbitration agreement to decide whether class procedures are even available? And there have been some new recent decisions on that issue that I think are worth discussing a little bit. In 1985, the Supreme Court in the Mitsubishi case set forth a very fundamental principle, which I think we've now heard resonated from the outset of this conference, that arbitration is simply a change of forum. It's not a change in the substantive rights that somebody may vindicate. I contend that that underpinning is getting harder and harder to believe in the wake of Concepcion and Italian Colors. I think Zach's question of what's left of the effective vindication of rights doctrine raises that question very squarely. I think that that question comes up an awful lot when actually litigating an arbitration as well. And I guess I'd argue that I don't think that arbitration is inherently problematic. I think this goes to the trust but verify theme. I don't think that arbitration is inherently problematic, but I think when at every step of the process, the rules, whether it's discovery or confidentiality, and I'll touch on some others, when they tend to favor the party with greater bargaining power, which I think comes up a lot in my kinds of cases, there are questions about where procedure bleeds into substantive rights. And I think we may be at a point where some, maybe a correction is due. And I think that'll come through in some of the themes that I bring out here. First, talk about some differences between arbitration and court and litigating Title VII cases, which is what I spend most of my time on. Let's start with perhaps the most obvious difference. There's no jury in arbitration. I try my cases, especially pattern or practice cases, to a jury. I don't have that option in arbitration. Instead, I try my case to an arbitrator, or sometimes a panel of arbitrators. There are many scholars, I think Professor Suja Thomas, who's at the University of Illinois, comes to mind, who have built a body of scholarship focused on the decline of the jury as an institution and the hardship that that can visit, particularly on the plaintiffs. I think arbitration is a good case study of that. And this theme about the jury and arbitration is front and center for those of you who are heading down to DC for the American Constitution Society conference next week. Paul Bland, Professor Thomas, Eric Mogilniki of Covington, and I are going to be speaking on the decline of the jury and the role of arbitration on that next week. So more to come on that issue soon. Second, confidentiality, which I think arbitration proceedings are ordinarily confidential. That's a hallmark of them. It's what it makes them so appealing for many employers, I think. But class claims are different. And as the AAA supplementary rules for class arbitration note, the typical presumption of complete confidentiality in arbitration has to give way at least a little bit where the rights of unnamed class members are being determined. And I think that also goes to some of the questions around collateral estoppel and what effect a class arbitration decision can have. In my experience, even though there are these clear rules about confidentiality and about a shift in presumption when a class is actually certified in arbitration, I'm here to tell you that there is still a remarkable amount of motion practice over confidentiality and the public availability of materials filed with the arbitrator, so I'm talking about judicial materials, that bear on the rights of the members of a certified class. this, I think, is one example of why I deeply question the sort of conventional wisdom that arbitration is faster and less expensive. Class arbitration, and I'll go ahead and agree with Stolt-Nielsen on this. Class arbitration is not less expensive, and it is certainly not faster. And the kind of motion practice that we deal with, confidentiality is one example, I think is a real problem there. Another important question related to confidentiality, what law applies? How do we decide whether proceedings and materials filed with an arbitrator that impact the rights of unnamed class members, how do we decide whether those should be confidential or not? Obviously, if you're in federal court, you get to look to Rule 26C. The person or the party seeking a protective order has to make a showing of good cause. How does that intersect with the, in my case, with the AAA supplementary rules and their caution around confidentiality? Having to litigate what law applies and what the paradigm for making that determination should be stands in stark contrast to the clarity of the Rule 26 standard. Together with the lack of a jury, I think this strong presumption of confidentiality and the motion practice entailed in class cases can really disadvantage employees. Third, discovery and arbitration is supposed to be more limited. This is part of the informality and the speed that arbitration is supposed to provide the parties. And I think Zach mentioned Gilmer, where the court made clear that explicit limits on discovery don't invalidate an arbitration agreement. But note, it can go too far. Too strict of limits on discovery or too one-sided a set of rules can violate due process rights. And again, this is that line between where procedure and substance bleed together. The Fourth Circuit in the Hooters versus Phillips case called out a system, an arbitration system created by an employer that was just so unfair that it was a sham system unworthy of the name of arbitration. That's the Fourth Circuit's language. While it's possible that rules may be so unfair and so restrictive that a court finds that they violate due process, more often, employers and consumers have to play in a game with the rules written often by their adversary that can be unfair in many of ways, none of which actually rise to the level of a due process violation, but sort of a creep. One of my colleagues on the plaintiff side, Rick Seymour, did an interesting paper earlier this year entitled Navigating the Discovery and Evidence Roadmap in Arbitration. I think he did it for a conference that the AAA held. It's very interesting, and it goes, you know, really point by point through the kinds of issues that we tackle in discovery in both litigation and in, I mean, both in federal court litigation and in arbitration. And again, it really sort of gets into the details of how that can be different. Among the places to look to understand some of those differences are the rules, and I'd point you to the AAA rules and to the JAMS rules, Employment Rule 9, the AAA rules, and JAMS Employment Rule 2 and 17B. And again, this is another, I mean, this could be a whole different topic. Which arbitration forum you're litigating in and which rules apply can also completely change the game. The AAA employment rules specify that if there's a difference between them and the governing arbitration agreement, the AAA rules trump. JAMS rules have the exact opposite rule. So we find ourselves in a very complicated place. Fourth, related to this issue of limitations in discovery, there are also limitations on compulsory process in arbitration. It's quite challenging to compel the production of witness testimony or to get documents produced by a third party in arbitration. And the issue here derives from Section 7 of the FAA, which describes the contours of an arbitrator's power to summon people and the production of documents before him or her. The enforcement requires the district court, the district in which the arbitrator is sitting, to make a determination and enforce a subpoena. And the circuits are divided on the question of whether an arbitrator can compel only the testimony of a witness or also the production of documents by a third party. There's a whole universe of case law around this section of the FAA. It's very different than compulsory process in court. And here, yeah.
Is there a territorial limit to the district court's power under 45?
Sure, there is. And same problem in some level, but I think compounded in arbitration. So take, for example, and actually the person to look at on this is our very own arbitrator, the former magistrate judge Kathleen Roberts, who's written an interesting paper on this exact question of Section 7 of the FAA, how it intersects with Rule 45, and how you navigate that. It's just, in my mind, another important difference between being in federal court and being in arbitration. The scope of review, number 5. Section 10 of the FAA makes explicit the highly limited grounds under which a court can vacate an arbitral award. For example, obvious corruption on the part of the arbitrator, and whether an arbitrator has exceeded his or her authority under the agreement. This is very different from the kind of review permitted of a district court's decision, and it varies, obviously, based on the district court determination, but I think another difference. The issue of expense has come up. The issue of expense has come up in cases like Italian Colors, but I think there's a real question about what happens if somebody finds that that they don't have an incentive. It's too expensive. They can't. The value of their individual claim versus the cost of bringing that makes it impossible or not interesting, not worthwhile to vindicate their rights. And I think the New York Times series touches on that issue. I want to just spend a quick second on what happens around the kind of relief that you get or don't get. In the employment context, this issue comes up in whether a class waiver is permissible, where it interferes with the ability to obtain broad injunctive relief. In class employment cases, courts have found that individuals cannot seek broad systemic injunctive relief. This underscores that arbitration and district court are not just distinct forum, but can potentially interfere with the kind of remedy or relief available to a party. Let me just reflect very briefly on a more structural concern that I have that flows from the reality of practicing an arbitration. My experience has been that the parties cite to relevant federal and state law developed over time in federal and state court. There is no common law of arbitration. In fact, most arbitral awards are never even made public. They're certainly not precedential. I think this bears out some of the concerns that Zach quoted from the Gardner-Denver case. I have a genuine concern that as more and more cases, particularly in the employment and consumer spaces, are shunted into mandatory arbitration, the body of law on which we all rely grows older and older, with very little new material to show us the way. A gap develops and grows, and ultimately, in my view, can lead to an atrophy of the common law system itself. And I don't know what to make of that, because obviously arbitration is here to stay, but there's a real cautionary tale. I'm out of time, but I do want to point you to a couple of very interesting cases that I think answer the question, or raise the question for the Supreme Court left open in Stolt-Nielsen, of who decides this question of clause construction. Is it a procedural issue for the arbitrator to decide, or is it a gateway issue for the court to decide? Three circuits now. The Fourth Circuit in the Del Webb Communities versus Carlson case from just a couple of months ago. The Third Circuit The Third Circuit in Chesapeake Appalachia versus Scout Petroleum, and the Sixth Circuit in Reed Elsevier versus Crockett all have drawn upon the language of Stolt-Nielsen and Concepcion that class arbitration is somehow such a fundamentally different animal than bilateral arbitration, that this issue then of clause construction really is a gateway issue. That's what these three circuits have contended. I think, again, this goes to the overall theme that we've been talking about where procedure bleeds into substantive rights. I think this is the latest chapter in that, and I expect that we may be hearing from the Supreme Court if a circuit split develops. So far, all three circuits to rule on this have gone the same way. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kalpana. So we're going to shift topics just slightly and talk about arbitration agreements for individual employment claims in the union context. So this is a little bit of merging of two areas that once were separate that happened in the Pyett case. And we've got two speakers who I think can speak very well to this case. The first speaker is Paul Salvatore, who is the co-chair of the Global Labor and Employment Law Department at Proskauer Rose. And he also happened to be the attorney who argued the case in Pyett. And so he can tell us a little more about that. And speaking with him is Terry Meginniss, who is the general counsel of Local 32BJ, which is the union that was involved in the Pyett case. And I'm going to turn it over to them to talk a little bit more about the arbitration of individual employment claims in the union context.
In another rare agreement that we've reached between us, I'm going first. Local 32BJ represents doormen, porters, commercial cleaners in office buildings in New York City, and security personnel in commercial buildings in New York City. About 50,000 of those employees are covered by bargaining agreements that we have with the major realty multi-employer association here in New York, the Realty Advisory Board. And that those agreements have a particular clause that was the subject of 14 Penn Plaza against Pyett, and the court held that that clause, which provides that statutory discrimination claims should be brought under the collective bargaining agreement in the arbitration form that's set in that collective bargaining agreement, that that clause has the effect of waiving covered individuals' right to go to a judicial forum to pursue the same claims because the clause was clear and explicit that it covered discrimination claims, and it was clear and explicit that the arbitration forum was to be the exclusive forum in which those claims would be heard. Following that decision, and the union was actually not a party to the case, it was an amicus in the case, and raised with the court a concern that the court did not decide, and that was the concern, what happens when the union, which is the gatekeeper on all claims that goes to, that will go to arbitration, decides not to take an individual employee's claim of discrimination to arbitration? That gatekeeping function is incredibly important to this union. The union probably takes only a third of the claims that employees bring to the union, complaints about workplace problems. It probably ends up taking only about a third of those to arbitration, largely because it determines in the course of looking at those claims that they're not meritorious. But there are other reasons. Pyett is an example. In Pyett, the individuals complained about a particular workplace resolution that had been entered into between the union and the employer. And the Pyett plaintiffs contended that that resolution had an age discriminatory effect that violated the Age Discrimination Act. The union disagreed. That happens as well. So post-Pyett, the union and the RAB were faced with the question of whether, in those circumstances in which the union decides not to go to arbitration, whether the individual is deprived of any forum at all or is consigned to some kind of arbitration forum that is either independent of the contractual forum, or whether the union has to step aside and let the individual go to the contractual forum, even though it doesn't want to. The first of those three options, if the employee had been left without a forum, could have had the consequence that the individual would have the right to go to a judicial forum after all, because Pyett made clear what was initially stated in Mitsubishi, that you can't have you can't enforce a waiver of a judicial forum right in such a way that it deprives an individual of the substantive right. And if you don't have a forum to go to, you can't vindicate in any way a claim of discrimination. So, with that knotty problem in mind, we disagreed, and we're set to go to arbitration on the contractual question of what happens in these instances when the union declines to take an individual's case to arbitration. And on the eve of arbitration, we agreed not to reach agreement. And we instead created a system where all of these claims, when an individual, when the union has decided they will not be brought to arbitration, they are sent to a mandatory mediation. Mediation is paid for by the RAB and the union. That is, the mediator is paid for by the RAB and the union. But the RAB and the union are not parties to the to the mediation. The employer is, and the individual employee who may be represented. The protocol gives mediators some pretty extraordinary powers, with the idea that the mediators will effect resolutions. Our thought about this was that because most of these claims were claims where the union had decided they were not meritorious, many of the claims would ultimately be resolved in mediation fairly promptly. And in fact, that has proved to be the case. I think at last count is about 2/3 of the cases have been resolved in the mediation process. Those that are not resolved, the individual is left with a kind of choice as to where to go. They might go to court and risk having the court decide that they don't have a right to be there, but they must go to some arbitration forum somewhere. Or they have the right to go to an arbitration forum that the employer and the individual will design, and the parties will assist. That is, the RAB and the union will assist in a sense of giving them a room and a list of arbitrators and a phone number and telling them, figure it out. And that is our protocol. It is far from perfect, but it has had some salutary effects, I think. By leaving the question open about whether a judicial forum really is available, I think that's put some pressure on some employers to compromise these claims. We have found also that a number of the individuals who are represented by attorneys where mediation has failed have chosen to go to arbitration instead of risking going to court for reasons that I think have to do with the scope of the claim and the strength of the arguments are crystallized in the mediation process, and the arbitration forums have resulted in some fairly speedy resolutions, some in favor of plaintiffs and some not. So that's all I have to say.
So I agree with everything Terry has said. We designed a system that works for this particular industry, and the types of employment that exist in the real estate industry, the building service industry in the New York area. These are buildings that employ, in some cases, a few handfuls, but no more than that, of workers. They aren't big companies for the most part, with the exception of a few of the cleaning contractors that have big labor relations and human resources departments. And labor relations kind of gets done on the building floor, if you will, on a day-to-day basis. The kind of disputes that come out of these workplaces are largely garden variety type disputes. It was the frustration with the fact that we had a very effective, although under the prior union administration, overused grievance and arbitration process that then resulted, after the employer would win in arbitration, that the doorman was proved that he had stolen and that's why he was fired, for example, that the next day the same doorman with a lawyer would show up in state or federal court and claim that it was race discrimination. And that's what led to the negotiation over several contracts in the 1990s of the clause that led to the dispute in Pyett, which led to the Supreme Court's decision in Pyett, which I always characterize as a quadruple win. It certainly was a win for the employers, the real estate industry employers generally, in terms of putting a stake in the heart of Gardner-Denver. I'm surprised people are still talking about Gardner-Denver at this conference because Sam ripped it out of his casebook and put Pyett in. Thank you, Sam. Second, it's a victory if you read the case for the institution of collective bargaining, which I think you're seeing the example of with this Pyett protocol that Terry has described. We have worked a lot of things out over the years, and in Pyett, the Supreme Court, first time in a long time, said, hey, the union plays a significant pivotal role in terms of the rights of its members under Section 9A of the National Labor Relations Act. So when it bargains, that means something. So I think it's a victory for collective bargaining and union management relations. Third, it's really a victory, and this is what I've been trying to say here, for these low wage or medium wage, lower middle class type workers that are in this industry and other industries like it, I think, where these clauses have been adopted, and they have been adopted around the country in a number of industries. Where the conditions are right, the kind of the soil conditions are right for it to take root, where there are good, long-standing labor management relationships, where the union has the ability to handle these claims because of sophisticated in-house or a combination of in-house and outside counsel, and where the types of claims otherwise would probably not really get much of a hearing. Often these are claims that the union has looked at and decided not to pursue. They'll pursue maybe the contractual claim, but they won't pursue the discrimination claim. And the employee still wants to pursue it. So mediation here is kind of the big star, if you will, of the process. It's like a big coffee filter that kind of takes away a lot of the claims. These are small workplaces. People may come back to the job. They may go to a different building and stay in the industry. To resolve these things in an amicable way is very helpful. So rather than being pro se in the state or federal courts, rather than finding a lawyer who's going to take more than any recovery would be, they have a forum, these workers, to go to that is safe, effective, fair, and one that has proven over the years resolution. This is also a victory for the court system. That's the fourth and the public interest, in my view, and our process. And here we may disagree a little, but it gives the union a chance to vet these cases and decide them. If people run into court, the court, and they haven't gone to the union, there's a jurisprudence that has developed under these clauses and the protocol in the Second Circuit courts that have, and the state courts that have said, no, you have to go back and you have to go to the union first and let them vet it. And sometimes even they've said you have to go to mediation, and sometimes they said no, you have to go through the arbitration procedure. This is a process that's taking claims that otherwise would clog our court system and not really get the kind of fair resolution they're getting in the mediation and arbitration process into the courts. So again, the perfect's the enemy of the good. But we've designed a system that has enough, I think, good that it is effective in dealing with the problems, certainly, that the real estate industry has faced. The employers like this system very much, and I think the union has been a terrific partner in helping develop it and administer it, and has grown to see the advantages of it for many of its members, despite some of our continuing disagreements on at least the underlying question of its full mandatoriness, if that's a word.
I think one other thing I would say is that on the availability to the union of the right to pursue those claims in itself in arbitration is an important and powerful tool. The union has pursued them and effected the kinds of workplace changes that were warranted by the discrimination that was found, and that was a powerful tool. We have the agreement of the RAB that all of the procedural devices and remedies that would be available under any of the state and federal laws and all of the statutes of limitations that would otherwise be available under those laws apply in those arbitrations. So that has been an effective part of making the process as a whole work. So we have reserved, actually, whether to go back to arbitration on the underlying fundamental question of whether the agreement itself requires that consigns an individual to arbitration, even if the union decides not to go. I told you we were on the eve of arbitration and we pulled back. We have agreed that that question is reserved and either party can take it to arbitration if they need to. That itself has had a salutary effect, I think, on our management of discrimination cases generally and issues related to the individual's claims in this protocol that I've described.
Thanks to you both. Can I clarify? I'm going to guess that there is no class waiver in your agreement.
I would agree with that. There's no class waiver in our agreement.
I'm going to guess that, but Paul, is there anything clearly on either point about class arbitration in there?
The issue really hasn't come up, but the union certainly has brought class arbitrations in the past and has the right to do so under the collective bargaining agreement. Not in this area, but I mean, this is an industry where, you know, people work cleaning people in office buildings at night. We have, you know, woman population in the workforce. You know, I could see those kind of claims being.
You didn't mean a population of large women, right?
But. No. A large number of women. Sorry. A large number of women in the workforce, and because they work alone at night in office buildings, and you know, we've had sexual harassment issues that have come up, and you know, so being able to bring those types of claims on a class basis is very effective, I think, for the prevention of you know, workplace issues in our industry. I've negotiated other agreements with other unions that do have class waivers in them, they've been enforced. So I think it depends on the industry.
So a very interesting intersection of topics going on. So we're going to circle back to another topic that's come up a couple times with some of our speakers and go into a lot more detail. Our next speaker has a bit to say about this. It's Chris Drahozal is the John M. Rounds Professor of Law and Associate Dean for Research and Faculty Development at the University of Kansas School of Law. And he has written and is involved on a number of arbitration topics, and he is going to speak about collateral estoppel, which I know a couple folks have asked about. Do arbitration awards have collateral estoppel effect, and what is the current state of the law about that question? So I'm going to turn it over to Dean Drahozal.
Yeah, and thankfully, Dean only for a few more weeks, because that is not something that frankly, it's not dean of the law school. It's an associate dean position. But thanks for the introduction. Thanks to Sam for the invitation. Thanks to you all for being here. As Elena said, my topic is, I'm going to call it issue preclusion rather than collateral estoppel, but that's sort of the restatement of judgments terminology, I guess. A couple disclaimers and then a couple clarifications before I get into the meat of what I want to talk about. The disclaimers are, well, first of all, I've been working with the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, mostly on its arbitration study, but a little bit on its proposed rulemaking. It goes without saying, I suppose, but I feel like I have to say it anyway. What I'm saying here are my own views, not the CFPB's views, not the US government's views. If you want to talk to the CFPB about their views, Eric Goldberg from the CFPB will be here tomorrow. So that's not me. Second, somewhat disclaimer, is my daughter actually works at Epic Systems and is a party to their arbitration clause, although she is not a technical writer, so I don't think she was a party to the possible class action that resulted in litigation we're going to hear more about. But it's very rare, frankly, for someone who writes about arbitration to actually have family members in know something about the process. So when she emailed me and said, oh, I just got this arbitration clause, it was like, wow, this is really exciting, because it's not something that usually comes up over the dinner table, let's put it that way. Now, as far as clarifications go, first is, my focus is not going to be on labor arbitration and the preclusive effects in that context. The sort of Pyett, Gardner-Denver stuff is beyond the scope of what I'm going to be talking about. Second clarification is, I was planning on talking about the preclusive effects of individual arbitration awards, not class arbitration awards, contrary to how other people might have perceived the topic. That said, given that there seems to be some interest in, and it's clearly a relevant topic, I can give you a few quick thoughts on the issue. So this goes back to Justice Alito's concurrence in Oxford Health Plan's case, okay? And what the court may have, well, and it goes back beyond that, it really goes back to the Basel case, where a plurality of the court held that deciding whether an arbitration clause permits or authorizes class arbitration, the plurality there said it was an issue for the arbitrator, okay? But Basel was a mess of a case, there were multiple opinions, and so no one really knew for sure what the rule was, although it sort of led to all the class arbitration that's happened since then. In Stolt-Nielsen, I think the court was planning on clarifying that, only to discover, probably after it granted cert, that the parties had agreed that the arbitrator should decide that issue. So I think the hope was, well, let's resolve this issue that was kind of a mess after Basel, but the parties had agreed for the arbitrators to decide it, so the issue wasn't presented. And so then the court did all sorts of nasty stuff in Stolt-Nielsen to potentially screw up the arbitration process that ended up getting fixed in Oxford Health Plans. But so Stolt-Nielsen didn't do much on that issue other than to totally trash Basel and say it's a plurality opinion, it's not really good law. Okay. Oxford Health Plans potentially raised the issue again, except again the parties there had agreed to have the arbitrators do it to resolve the issue. So the Supreme Court has never gotten back to the issue in Basel. Okay. And that's the reason for sort of, frankly, it's really the, I think, as far as, it is still an important open question as to how courts deal with class arbitration. Now, what in concurrence Justice Alito said was, well, wait a minute here. The majority, or the court, essentially decided that, well, or emphasized that, the parties had agreed to have the arbitrators decide whether the clause permits class arbitration. That's probably not quite accurate, right? Because all the parties weren't there. Okay? The class representative agreed to have the arbitrators decide what the arbitration clause precluded. And so Justice Alito's point is, all the absent class members didn't agree to that. Okay? And so if the court makes a decision and the arbitrators end up entering an award on a class basis, it all depends on whether the parties agreed to have them do that, and the absent parties never agreed, okay? So then the question is this something that the court decides or the arbitrators decide? Because if it's something the arbitrators decide, then the court will defer. But if it's something the court decides, as Alito's point was, we would find that the parties never agreed to this in the first place, and so the whole thing goes away. Okay? So it's not really a preclusion question so much, I don't think, as a question of who decides this issue, which then goes back to Kalpana's point that that's an open question. Okay. Now, as far as individual arbitration goes, okay, the reason I think this is a question is Concepcion and the cases dealing with arbitration clauses and class waivers. Okay? Because there's really two ways the legal system has developed, two principal ways anyway, to address what David Rosenberg at Harvard calls somewhat loadedly duplicative litigation of similar claims. So if you take Uber for an example, right? There's multiple class actions raising the question of whether Uber drivers are employees or independent contractors. And I think in California alone, there were alleged to be 160-some thousand people who've driven for Uber since it began, who are possible members of that class. Okay. And all of them, not exactly the same issue, but a pretty similar issue, right? Which is, are they independent contractors or are they employees? Okay. We could basically have 160,000 individual cases resolving that question, okay, which is, gets to the duplicative litigation point, right? That's pretty costly. Pretty inefficient. We've kind of done that before. Okay. What are the ways the legal system has developed to address those sorts of settings? Well, class actions are one, right? You have a class representative who essentially litigates the case, and the result of a class action, either settlement, which is typically what happens, or on the merits, is that all the absent class members are bound, right? We don't have to do this 160,000 times. We do it one big complicated time, potentially. Assuming it gets to that point, but class actions are one way that the law has designed to deal with that. Okay? After Concepcion, if you have an arbitration clause and a class waiver, class actions aren't going to work, subject to EPIC and NLRA, the Section 7 and National Labor Relations Act in the employment context. Okay? But the class the means of dealing with these sorts of cases of class actions is largely, at least potentially, limited if not gone away. So what else do courts do? Well, another way courts deal with this type of problem is through the issue preclusion doctrine, issue preclusion collateral estoppel, right? You litigate it, okay? At least the parties to the case are going to be bound by that litigation. But if you, the Supreme Court recognized you can do this in Park Lane Hosiery, if you have non-mutual offensive collateral estoppel, a plaintiff in a second case after the defendant loses the first case, right? So the first Uber driver wins, okay, Uber loses, Uber driver number two can come up and say, under Park Lane Hosiery, Uber's bound. Okay? And again, it addresses this issue of lots of cases raising the same issue. Okay? Now, it's not as sort of neat and clean, is a good way to describe it, or burdensome or risky as a class action, because there's some discretion involved, and there may be sort of multiple times this is going on. It's not sort of once and for all necessarily at the same time, but it's another technique to get to the same issue, to deal with the same types of cases. Okay, and so then the question that I addressed in the paper that I wrote, and I'm planning on talking about the rest of my time is, well, if we're not talking about court, we're talking instead about arbitration. Can you use an individual arbitration, or can an individual arbitration award have non-mutual issue preclusive effect? And the short answer is, in many places, it seems to me, yes, that is the case. There's some complications, which I'll get to, okay? But if you look at the restatement of judgments, restatement second of judgments, for example, the rule is very clear that the arbitration award has the same preclusive effect as a court judgment, subject to all the same limitations and prerequisites. Okay? Now, there's an exception to that I'll come to. That's the majority approach. Okay? Now, there are requirements that have to be met for issue preclusion to be available at all. Okay, and then in addition, there's the discretion, okay, to recognize or permit non-mutual offensive issue preclusion. Okay. But if you look at the requirements for issue preclusion, right, at least they sort of standard, there's sort of lots of variations on this, but you need to have the same issue. It needs to actually have been decided in the original proceeding. It needs to have been essential to the decision in the original proceeding, and the party who's being bound has to have a full and fair opportunity to litigate. And it seems to me there's good arguments that all of those will be met in an individual employment arbitration. Sort of empirically, how often that's actually the case, I'll leave to you all litigate them. I have no basis for commenting on that. But at least it's possible, okay? I mean, same issue, That's going to depend on what the issue is. Okay. Full and fair litigation, right? I mean, there's sort of, this is view of arbitration as an informal process that maybe doesn't have all the same procedural protections or rights or burdens as litigation would. Okay. If we're talking about a case where an employee wins, okay, the fact that there may have been less less discovery in arbitration clearly didn't preclude the employee from winning. And I guess it seems to me, well, I mean, one of the criticisms of arbitration now is actually it's becoming less informal, right? Becoming more formal, more judicialized. The more judicialized arbitration gets, the fuller and fairer opportunities to litigate, it seems to me there likely are. And if you look at things like the AAA or JAMS employment rules, the employment due process protocol, all move arbitration towards a more formal, fuller and fairer opportunity to litigate process, at least arguably so. And then there's the question of whether the issue was actually litigated and decided and essential to the decision. The challenge there, and this goes to Kalpana's comments about the sort of publicity given to the arbitration process, is just sort of twofold. One is the traditional American rule has always been there's no obligation on the part of arbitrators to issue reasoned awards. They have to give a written award for it to be enforceable under the Federal Arbitration Act, but it doesn't have to be reasoned. They can just say the answer, okay? And there certainly are cases saying, well, we can't apply issue preclusion when all you have is an answer like this because we can't tell what was actually decided in the prior case. Okay. That's not how AAA employment arbitration or JAMS employment arbitration works, right? The default rule there actually is that there has to be a reasoned opinion, a reasoned award. Okay. So the sort of general commercial default rule has been changed in the employment context, so that you may actually have a way to figure out what was actually decided in the prior case. The second concern is a practical one, I think, and that is that how does somebody know what was decided in another arbitration proceeding if, as Kalpana says, arbitration is confidential? And I guess here I would take a little issue with that characterization because so those of you who do it may have a different impression, but my understanding is arbitration is not confidential, it's private. Okay, and that may not sound like much of a difference, but it really is. There's a duty of confidentiality on the part of the arbitrators and on the part of the arbitration institution, okay, subject to the AAA rules now allowing them actually to publish employment arbitration awards, subject to state laws requiring providers to release information about employment arbitrations. Okay. So there is a duty there subject to these modifications. And frankly, these are pretty important modifications, right? I mean, if you actually can find out who the businesses are involved in AAA arbitrations from California and other state disclosures, and the AAA's published the opinion, albeit on a redacted basis, you may be able to put two and two together and actually get the awards that way. But even if you can't get the awards that way, okay, there's no confidence, as a sort of default arbitration law matter in the United States, there's no confidentiality obligation on the part of the parties. And the AAA actually says this in, I can't remember what the document's labeled, their statement of ethical principles. Okay. They describe arbitration, the AAA describes arbitration as a private process, okay, that the AAA staff and neutrals have an obligation to keep information confidential, but the parties always have a right to disclose details of the proceeding unless they have a separate confidentiality agreement. Okay. So arbitration is not confidential, okay, in and of itself as far as the parties go. Okay. There's certainly nothing stopping the parties from going to the press or Congress saying, I've got this problem with an employer. That happens all the time. The famous Jamie Lee Jones case about the Halliburton employee, she was testifying before Congress, even though she was a party to an arbitration clause that later was held not to apply to the dispute, but at the time she was testifying, she had agreed to arbitrate. It didn't prevent her from talking about what had happened. But this isn't just talking about what happened in the underlying dispute, it also applies about what's going on in arbitration. Okay? Unless there's a confidentiality agreement, arbitration, again, this is my understanding, in the United States, and there's, I think Australia's got a different rule, but we're not in Australia, arbitration is not a confidential process, okay? Now, there may well be a confidentiality provision, right? There was an article in the New York Times deal book a couple years ago about American Apparel, where the CEO had various sexual harassment, if not worse, issues with models who were posing, okay? The headline of the article was arbitration allows American Apparel to hide its wrongdoing. And then you read the article and it basically says arbitration clause and confidentiality agreement. So it's not arbitration per se that does it, it's the confidentiality agreement that's the key here. So as a practical matter, again, it's not like you can go to the clerk's office and find prior decisions the way you could in court, but I don't think confidentiality is nearly the problem that it's often perceived to be. So again, bottom line here is majority approach is arbitration awards have issue preclusive effect if you can meet the requirements, okay? Basically the same as a court judgment. In fact, if you think about arbitration statutes basically say if you get it confirmed in court, it's turned into a court judgment with all the same effects as a court judgment. Okay. Now, there are exceptions. The leading exception is California in the Vandenberg case, where California basically held, the Supreme Court held, that arbitration awards do not have non-mutual offensive issue preclusive effect unless the parties to the original arbitration so agreed, which nobody's ever going to do. Okay, so essentially, it's basically they don't have that sort of effect. And Utah has followed that. Most other states that have addressed the issue have rejected that approach. It seems to me there's a potential. Well, sort of one thing to be clear about, the California Supreme Court made clear that this was decided only on the basis of California arbitration law, not the Federal Arbitration Act. And if you read through the opinion, it's essentially based on a view of arbitration as an informal process that doesn't have any sort of process and any sort of procedures with it like courts would. I don't know that it would be preempted by the FAA, but I'm not confident that it wouldn't be. It seems to me there's a question about whether that rule would survive a preemption challenge. Okay. But at least as of now, again, California and Utah have followed the minority approach, which is, again, essentially, unless the parties have agreed otherwise, no non, and again, parties being the ones to the original case, okay, have agreed that, unless they have agreed that there is non-mutual offensive issue preclusive effect. Okay. Now, a couple of other issues that, I have a couple minutes left, that arise in this context that I think are worth emphasizing. Okay. The first is, who decides, it's a question of who decides this issue. It goes back to sort of the gateway issue that we've talked about. Okay. Issues on the merits essentially are things that courts don't decide, and they're left to the arbitrators to decide. So if you have a case where the second arbitration or the subsequent time this issue arises is in arbitration rather than in court, okay, courts have pretty consistently held the court shouldn't be deciding whether this issue preclusive effect, it should be the arbitrators. Okay, it's basically seen as a merits type issue, maybe a couple of exceptions, but it's an issue that the arbitrator should decide. Second, and I think this is sort of an interesting potential variation on this question that kind of may parallel what's going on in the class setting is, there are rare, but they do exist, contract provisions that essentially say no issue preclusive effect of any arbitration awards. I think there's one contract, it actually may be Sterling Jewelers. If you go on, the CFPB has a webpage where you can look at all credit card agreements. And if you Google, I don't remember what those, you sort of search for the terms, the Sterling Jewelers is the only contract that pops up that essentially says no arbitration award will have any preclusive effect as to issues or claims involving anyone who is not a party to this arbitration. Okay, so it's essentially an issue preclusion waiver, right? The same way you have class arbitration waivers. If courts give that effect, and frankly, I guess I should say that the sort of restatement of judgments rule is courts should give effect to that, basically those provisions are enforceable, okay? And so under that rule, if the contract had this sort of provision, the issue preclusive effect that I've been talking about would go away. It seems to me there's a couple possible responses. One is that this is unconscionable, okay? There's been a couple times it's been claimed. I haven't been able to find any cases in which it's been adjudicated, but if this issue sort of develops, then one would certainly expect that to the people, employees or consumer groups to start arguing that these provisions are unconscionable to try to preserve the issue preclusive effect. The second approach is an interesting one by the New York Appellate Division in a case in 2012 where it dealt with this. Actually, a lot of these cases are from New York state courts. The Appellate Division essentially said, well, what this type of clause means is that it's sort of not effective of its own right. Essentially, the parties stating they have no intent to fully and fairly litigate this issue, right? If you go back to the requirements for issue preclusion, one of the requirements for an award to have issue preclusive effect is that the parties have to fully and fairly litigate the issue. Well, the way the court construed this language was, well, this is the party saying up front, we don't intend to do that. Hence, there would be no issue preclusive effect, okay? Which maybe makes some sense. The interesting part is the court's follow-up is then, however, in this case, they still went ahead and fully and fairly litigated the issue. So there still is issue preclusive effect despite this language. But there's not even a waiver, right? It's more of a statement of intent, and what they actually did was inconsistent with what the contractual stated intent was. Okay. We'll see how this all develops. I'm not sure these issues I can't imagine they will rise to the prominence of the class issues in Concepcion and Italian Colors, But this is at least a possible follow-on to those sorts of to the class issues that have come up, and I'll be curious to see how this comes out. So, thank you all.
Thank you. So our last set of speakers in this section and our last topic is going to be a criticism of employment arbitration in the non-union context. And this is going to be from the perspective of union side lawyers. So we've got, and I know folks may need to, you know, have a little break, but if you can keep it down, we've got one more set of speakers here. We've got two speakers. We have Dan Engelstein, who is a principal at Levi Ratner and who has over 35 years of experience representing employees and as a labor lawyer. And we also have Gene Eisner, who is president of Eisner & Associates, who also has substantial experience in the field. And I think, Dan, I think you're going to speak first. There you are. And then I think we're going to have Gene comment. And I'm going to let you guys take it away.
Okay, first, my real claim to fame, I've been up all night negotiating, is that my brother, Larry Engelstein, works with Terry Meginniss. I'm going to sort of depart from what I had prepared somewhat because I don't really want to be duplicate some of the things that were said before, and I want to respond to some of the things. I'm trying to discuss today from the point of view of my labor arbitration experience the dangers that I see of using arbitration, mandatory arbitration, to enforce employment discrimination. I will try to share some thoughts about how to ameliorate some of the worst facets of mandatory arbitration in the hope of provoking some discussion. I'm a little bit like a bowl in a china shop, but I'll try to at least get somebody moving in that direction. But before I do, I want to make it clear, and I don't think it's been made clear, that these are all judicially created doctrines. Congress never decided that the FAA would have preclusive effect. Congress never decided that there should be mandatory arbitration. You know, if you are a labor historian, a legal historian, or you just see how the court has flip-flopped all over the time, you will understand that the FAA actually had an exclusion. When Fred Braid and I first started practicing, that exclusion, we said, well, you know, can we really go to court and confirm an award by using the fast-track procedure? And we sort of did it, but, you know, everybody knew it was a little bit of fugazi. You ever heard that from Brooklyn, right? And because everybody understood that it didn't apply to employment agreements. All right? And then there was this Alexander, that what you now, or no, not you, but Sam wants to bury. And the court said specifically, you know, we don't want to have private judges deciding public rights. So what happens is, and it's very interesting, at that time, there were no juries, right? It was just going to the judge on the Title VII. What happens? In 1991, Congress says, you know, this is not working. We really got to do something about this. We got to really enforce this statute because discrimination is a problem. And it's still a problem, as we know, because polarization has now become popular throughout the world and throughout our nation. It's still pervasive, it still exists, and it's worse now because it's more hidden. But Congress said, we want to take it away from the judges and give it to the jury, and we're going to put some heavy-duty damages on. So the court who said arbitrators shouldn't replace judges, who we all know from Cardozo, Holmes, the legal realists, are themselves have their own biases and are not the most appropriate fact finders, that they, arbitrators should not replace them, but all of a sudden the court now says
Congress decided that juries should decide it. A diverse number of perspectives. Maybe they get it right, maybe they get it wrong, but at least it's a fair shot at somebody understanding the plainness of these cases who come from different economic groups, different backgrounds, et cetera, et cetera. And the court now decides, having done, I guess, tremendous amount of social science research. Oh, I forgot I gotta flick this thing, yeah? Right? I gotta move along. That arbitrators are just neutral substitutes for juries. No impact on statutory remedies. And no loss of deterrent effect. Well, what I wanted to speak about, though, because there's a lot of issues that people have raised. But the one issue is, and I may offend some of my arbitrator friends, but and a lot of plaintiff's lawyers would agree with me. I've talked to some. The fundamental issue is the arbitrator. Who are they? Are they really capable of rendering a decision? Now, again, I go back to Gilmore. I mean, I read a bunch of articles by some people here, some, you know, all interesting. But what everybody agrees on is that there is a consensus about implicit bias, that people don't even know that they're biased, and that we have cognitive habits which are adaptive to everyday life, from which we infer from a small amount of data filtered through our experiences, our prejudices, things that we now think are true. And as some great jurists of all time said, if you really think you are making an unbiased decision, you're fooling yourself. So I think that what we have to look at, and by the way, the other issue, and I'm going to move it a little along because I don't want to go too far, but you know, this repeat player business. Now, we know, come on, us guys in the labor arbitration business, that we hack the arbitrators. We don't like them, boom, they're gone. All right? Now, but the difference is you got two sides axing them. That's not going to happen. And, you know, there's argument about whether it's a good regression analysis, a bad regression analysis, but what I read seems to think that there is evidence that the repeat player effect is significant, and I don't need that stinking evidence because it's common sense. I mean, I had a plaintiff's lawyer tell me that some podunk employer who this arbitrator would never see again, but she's pretty, you know, she's the heavy hitter in New York. And she said, this guy was going to throw me the case. He had to because I had a good case, but I think he would have thrown it to me anyway.
So animated, he reminds me of
Oh. Sorry, I thought somebody was throwing something at me.
He was, he just didn't want you to hear it.
Okay. So I guess I'm not. So I'm going to move. Juries, of course, and I was on a jury, and I saw this in action. You know, you saw these cognitive habits, the anchoring, you know, when some, you know, because that's what we all do as litigators. We try to look through this prism so you'll see everything through the way we want, right? Or the confirmation bias, right? And I saw it. They hated the plaintiff. And they were not even going to find a liability until I said, wait, there's two separate issues. She's faking the injury, but whatever. You know, Sam, for the first time when they answered the question, can you follow the instructions? I said, yes. So you say if arbitration is so bad, why are we doing it for so long with labor? And let's look at why. It's bilateral. Hey, two of us, you know, these guys here. You know, nobody's messing with 32 B, J. So the arbitrators know that. Okay? deciding private issues. They don't do external law. And just the mere fact that they have to think about what the parties intended when they did the agreement is at least one step along going outside yourself. Because you can't just say, well, this is what I think should happen. You have to think, well, what did they think should happen? I mean, they still mess it up, but at least they have to go that step. They're not deciding what a reasonable woman would, you know, think is offensive. You know, like, so, you know, here you have the arbitral function interpreting parties' private agreement. Both parties are institutional entities. They have an ongoing relationship, repeat players. They can undo an arbitration award. And process is secondary to the result. It's the self-governance that labor arbitration brings, which is the policy issue, not the result of a particular case. That is not true in statutory obligations. There, the result is what matters. It is the enforcement of the obligation. In addition, the labor arbitrator, I got to do writing now, the labor arbitrator enforces the status quo. The reason we have discrimination laws is to disrupt the status quo. So it's a totally different function. So let's look at mandatory arbitration. I got 1 minute. Oh, I better talk.
We got to leave some time for some commentary.
All right, I got to go quick then. All right, so anyway, basically, it's not the equivalent, right? We all know that. But I want to get to my solutions, leveling the playing field. I'm sorry I took too long, but I had three suggestions. Most of my friends told me they're nonsense, but I didn't want to just say dump it because nobody's, what good is that? I said training and certification of arbitrators. AAA says they can have employment law experience. With all due respect, anybody can learn that. What you need is how to listen to people, to understand people from different perspectives, to have what the social psychologists say is empathy, not sympathy, empathy. The ability to think, eliminating disparity in selection process. Once you've got this panel, it's a rotation, baby. You don't get to pick. Arbitrators are going to be independent. They're not going to say, you know what? You messed up. Puny damages. I'm going to get picked again because I did my job. You're not going to blackball me. Now, this is my favorite, and it's the most ridiculous, but it's really the best. Establishing uniform legal standards. This is a public statute. You have jury instructions. Now, if you want to give these arbitrators the kind of deference to their award, make them like juries. At least we have some semblance of equality, equivalence. Just you have clearly erroneous to the jury. Okay, so you have this deference to arbitrators. But the EEOC says these are the rules. And you have to apply them. And the final thing is, they say training really doesn't work so well, although the judges are trying it. They say the best thing to do is to make people write it out. Identify the steps from A to B. And if you need to get to sleep at night, read my paper. There's some good quotes about all these people and how you would do it. But that would be another thing, that you must issue an opinion so that when you understand that it is illogical to go to A and B, that you're probably relying on some subconscious cognitive illusion. And my final word is that I think there is some value to arbitration. I got to go. All right. I just want to say, when employers look at arbitration the same way they look at jury trials, then you have equity and the premise of the Supreme Court will have been met. I'm sorry, Gene, if I went over.
All right, Gene.
after that wonderful performance, I just have a few comments because, first of all, time is running out. I know Sam is getting edgy over there. First of all, I agree substantially with everything that Danny, my good friend Danny Engelstein, and I have been colleagues for many, many years. He's been at the bar for 35 years, as has been said. I've been at it for 52 years, so a little bit longer. And I remember some of the cases that are not even in his treatise, such as Lincoln Mills, by the way, which is not mentioned in his treatise, which is a case in 1957, which many of you may or may not remember from Labor Law 1 that Sam taught, that arbitration is a substitute for a strike, not for litigation. So remember that. It's the quid pro quo for if no strike, arbitration. If there's not a strike clause, then the parties don't have to. They can strike if there's no arbitration clause. Furthermore, Section 301 of Taft-Hartley did not contemplate arbitration of statutory claims. There's nothing in the congressional history that talks about contemplation of statutory claims in Section 301 of Taft-Hartley. In terms of bias of arbitrators and judges, the first section of Danny's treatise deals with bias, and it's true there's bias both by arbitrators and judges. What better bias can I give you an example than the vicious argument in Pyett, the split 5-4, Justice Thomas, the esteemed Justice Thomas, said in his majority opinion, he acknowledged that there was substantial dicta after Gardner-Denver for many, many years. But he said, interestingly enough, he thought, and I'm quoting now from Thomas's opinion, the critical problematic dicta that came after Gardner-Denver was the result of negative parochial and hostile view of arbitration as resolving employment discrimination suits. Can you imagine Mr. Justice Thomas referring to parochial and hostile view of cases? It's funny coming from his mouth. The dissent was written by Justice Stevens, and he was very angry. And he wrote a separate dissent. I'm sorry, Souter wrote the major dissent. But Stevens said that, I have to say further from what Souter said, in the absence of an intervening amendment to the relevant statutory language, we're bound by Gardner-Denver. It's for Congress rather than the court to reassess the policy arguments favoring arbitration and revise the relevant provisions to reflect its meaning. So that I happen to agree strongly with what Justice Stephen had to say. Incidentally, a case not too long ago that was brought by the EEOC on behalf of an individual who was subject to a mandatory arbitration clause, not in a collective bargaining agreement, but in an individual case. It was, for those of you who are interested in looking at it, it's EEOC versus Waffle House, 534 U.S. 279. The Supreme Court held that the EEOC was not bound by a mandatory arbitration clause, that the EEOC itself had a right to bring the case on behalf of the individual who himself was subject to the mandatory arbitration clause. And in taking a look at the cases that have followed the EEOC Waffle House case, there are thousands of cases that have cited the Waffle House case with approval. So for those of you who may be practitioners looking to defend individual people who may be subject to mandatory arbitration clause. Take a go to the EEOC, which is what my office does if we're faced with a mandatory arbitration clause. Time is running out. Let me just say that after the Concepcion case, which has been mentioned several times, the court was the Congress back in those days, before the domination by the Republicans, introduced the Arbitration Fairness Act, which has been introduced every year since 2009, to eliminate employee waivers of the right to litigate employer discrimination suits. The findings of this bill say that mandatory arbitration undermines the development of public law because there is inadequate transparency and inadequate judicial review of arbitration decisions. No pre-dispute arbitration agreement shall be valid or enforced if it requires arbitration of an employment, consumer, or civil right dispute. That bill has been introduced every year, and who knows, depending on what happens in November, and if Mr. Trump is at the top of the ticket, and the Republicans go down, there may even be a Democratic Congress, and the Arbitration Fairness Act may even get enacted. Thank you very much.
We have a few minutes for questions. Do we have anybody in the audience? I see someone. Do we have a couple people with mics in the audience.
She's coming over.
We have someone up front here.
She's right there. She's right there. Yeah, she's right there.
Okay. Hi. Thank you very much for the opportunity. It's very interesting. My question is regarding the incentives. I agree with the premise that there's a repeating clients factor, but I wanted to know if you think it also expands to the judicial system. And what I mean is that this week when we were at we visited the Supreme Court of New York, one of the judges, he joked that today they're competing against establishments like JAMS and AAA. And my question is, do you think that basically also has an effect on the actual judicial system?
I think judges, they get paid, they have no economic incentive. I know Zach didn't want to speculate, but I think you can pretty well speculate that one of the things that pushed the mandatory arbitration is they didn't want all these cases in court. And they were literally, once you had jury trials, they were flooded. My informal sources tell me, but I think that's accurate. So I don't think it's about the competition has anything to do with the court judges. Did I answer your question? I think everybody wants more vacation.
Right? Vive la France.
I mean, that said, there certainly is behavior by courts suggesting they want more of at least certain types of cases. So courts have set up business court specialties to try to attract.
That's what they visited, the commercial division. Can I ask?
They may be less interested in employment cases.
Also, Sammy, talk about the judges who wanted to do fast track cases.
Well, why don't you spell it out for me?
That judges, they offer employers fast-track cases as an alternative to arbitration, and no, we want to do the full boat on the discovery and this and that and everything. They said, and they want to do their motions, et cetera.
Sometimes employers, unlike union representatives, speak out of both sides of their mouth. Is that the claim?
No, I only speak out of one another question. Side, but I do
I want
take
to ask you another
positions.
Question. The repeat player effect. I mean, I looked at these studies. All these studies show is that if you're a large employer with a lot of experience, you'll have a better win-loss rate than a small employer without that experience. Hold off for 1 second.
Okay.
Now, that is true in litigation as well. If you're a large employer, you have an HR department, and you're also screening cases, typically most of the employment arbitration programs is mediation, which we'll talk about. So you get like an early screen there. That's all those studies show. They show nothing else. And let me add one more point. With the organization of the plaintiff bar, I don't know if you're a member of it, but there's something like the communication among plaintiff representatives about arbitrators.
Okay.
Now, there are going to be some individuals that do not have quality representation, a problem in lots of places. But in New York, at least, I think D.C., the plaintiff bar, in fact, I'm speaking of the NLA annual meeting.
Okay.
In 2 weeks.
Can I answer?
It's an enormous organization of plaintiff lawyers.
All right, let me answer. I think I said there were these studies, but I don't need to rely on these studies because I've been living with these guys for 35 years, and I know what floats their boat, and I know how they react. And I'll show you one example of it. In labor law, when unions have diminished power, the arbitrators go pro-management because they're not afraid. Decisions that, if they were rendered in the 1950s, would have caused a walkout are suffered in silence because of the change. When I started practicing, Tommy Knowlton, who was on the War Labor Board, I thought was wonderful. He empathized with everybody. Sylvan Elias, who started practicing in 19...
practicing World War II?
No, he was on the War Labor Board. But Sylvan Elias, who passed the Hammurabi Code to get into the bar, he said Tommy Knowlton was one of the conservatives in the late 40s. And if you read the arbitration manuals, these arbitrators have continually shifted, but it's okay there, because that's the function of collective bargaining. You don't have the strength, you're gonna suffer the consequences. But it's not okay in mandatory arbitration. And if you like arbitration, make it voluntary.
Sam, I'd like to just make a comment, if I may. I meant to add that when Paul Salvatore said that Pyett drove a stake in the heart of Alexander Vigodin of Denver, I disagree with that. Because as Mr. Justice Thomas himself said, we're not overruling Gardner Denver. We're distinguishing the case. And as I know, as a practitioner and representing a number of unions, a lot of unions do not have the omnibus discrimination clause that 32BJ had. And if you don't have that omnibus specifically enumerating all of the different discrimination cases, then you do have a right to go to court and not be subject to mandatory arbitration.
Great. Do we have anybody else with questions? All right, so.
We reconvene at 11:15. Thank you for the panel.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you.